And this is the list of the 10 good things that I have learned and observed while I'm volunteering at the conferences, at conventions. And each and every one of them are actually beyond helpful. So the first one is that things will go bad. Something will be wrong. Someone did it not the way it was supposed to be done. Something is missing. Someone was not on top of the game. And the first mental thing is that people think the worst. Like, I had a case in a previous company where there was a massive screw-up because stressed, a lot of stuff to be done. And by marking one test scenario as passed in preliminaries, ended up with massively delayed deadlines for the customer because on the next stage we found that there is actually a brutal mistake in there. Led to managers actually questioning whether I didn't try to sabotage, which is kind of, you try to be helpful and then you're being told that she probably tried to destroy everything. So it's not that easy to remember that person probably didn't mean no harm by what they did. It's just try to get over those emotions and then try to clarify with the person who might have said something hateful, but the person was under the emotions and the person did not even anticipate that that might actually hurt. So being polite is important. So occasionally I do say, like, go and say, what the fuck, dude, to the developer who screwed up a bit. But it's not the default reaction. It's like, if you try politely a lot of stuff, sometimes you just have to use mud occasionally. And the third point is about the, so person tried to be helpful, the person tried to do something that wasn't the person's job, but it needed to be done. And obviously when the person who knows more about this task sees this madness, their action is like, don't touch the stuff, you don't know how it works, because you're destroying even more. So try to forgive them and then educate them why this and this was more important than the stuff that you did. And number four is, if you, for example, get into the argument, so as a testers, we kind of try to inform why we think that's a bad thing, like why we shouldn't do it like that. And it might clash with the product owners, so I have actually had a lot of arguments with my product owners. And sometimes the point I'm giving is okay. Sometimes the point the product owner gives me back is, the thing is, opinions will clash, but you have to try and see why the other person sees this is important. So it's about communicating, explaining, why do I think that this is bad? And at first my product, the Scrum product owner was, she did say later on, that it intimidates the hell out. So we go into the grooming session and then this tester brutally murders the idea. But the idea is that I'm not attacking her for creating the idea, I'm attacking the idea, attacking is a bad word, I'm debunking the idea to show how I can see it could break the system if it goes as it is. And it takes time and building trust and seeing where that, for example, my priorities are with the product. And after the person gets used to that, she's not attacking me, but she is focusing on the product, we can continue on. But until then, it sounds like this loud person is just not accepting any of ideas I have, and she probably hates me a lot for no apparent reason. So some thoughts like that also happen with the people. How much time do I have? Good. That's good. So what else do we have here? So number five, I think it, I kind of assume it's obvious to everyone, especially in the Agile community and companies trying to do Agile, is the communication. The thing is, too many words is not helpful, but without sharing and talking and trying to show how it works for whom, we will not be able to get things done without extra reworks. So talking is important. So that's also the bit, be clear and try to be on spot. That's another little thing I'm not all that good at. It's kind of hard to balance between when you try to give all the context to it, the person is like, for fuck's sake, just give me what's wrong with it. And then the next time you go with, what the fuck is wrong with it? It's like, can you give me a context for this? So it's hard to balance, and you never know when to be how concise. So that's why the second bit in there, forgive them if they're super spot on with the things, and you still have in the mode between switching the context. So there might be, yeah, communication isn't easy. Okay, so the seventh is about my habit of, I do this in a bad way. So whenever someone asks me, I have kind of spoiled people around me with, ask Guna, she will respond on spot. And sometimes the questions I get is not something that was worth my time. So it's about these little things. So if you get a bunch of requests, let the people know how the team works, because your team actually has to take a bigger priority as people around you. I'm not saying that you shouldn't collaborate with other teams. You should. But there should be an established process on how it's being done, so we don't end up with Phoenix Project and this one person who's always being yanked to the emergencies or something. Because let's face it, most of the incoming questions might be just person bouncing off her ideas. But if you're always the available person, it means you're not available for your team and you can't be a proper member of the team and collaborate with the team good enough. And this is the eighth one is more from the conferences and conventions. Since the things will happen, people will get angry, but as organizers, you have to remember that it's not participants' fault that something went wrong. So you shouldn't project the negativity and frustration out in the open at the spot. Because the person who screwed up, trust me, the person is killing internally himself like 10 times in a row already. So it's not the best time to come up with the suggestions on the spot. Because also, I mean, on the spot, what happens, you haven't thought about it. So if you haven't thought about it, you have not tried to word it properly. So it also comes out wrong in that way. So it can make just things worse. So if something bad happens, get it done in a calm, respectful manner, and then schedule time to go through the lessons that you can learn and see if we can avoid this properly in the future. Some things you can't avoid. So for example, a typical bad thing that can happen for a conference, especially a tech one, Wi-Fi is no longer capable to facilitate everyone on it. This is something that is so bad, but the only thing that you can do is just invest shitloads of money on having your own hotspot, your own incoming internet that is not being totally abused. And two more. So those two are simple. So smile. If the magical thing is that there are some these weird muscles. So for example, do you know that when you call the pen like this, it's they are saying that it's mentally much better than when you just bite it like this, because it triggers the smile reflex. So what happens if you smile? It makes you feel better, even though you might not feel better, like good for smiling at that point. Too many words, sorry. So, and last one, which I'm gonna do right now. It's to stop and enjoy. So I will enjoy this moment till I see the feedback.
Thank you, Guna. We have time for questions. So?
Okay. You mentioned a bungee jump. Did you do it?
I did it. I did it. I also like the extreme carousels, which are freakishly scary when you look at them. So regarding the bungee jumping, I did there, and the thing that I did not expect that the toughest part is actually standing on that ledge and just letting go. So I managed to let go when I felt that they're going to push me. And then I just let go and I let my legs get weak and then I just flopped out of it. Which, and afterwards it was like, it was nice, and then it's like, wait, it's over? It was like, it was probably less than a minute, this fun stuff, and it was like, okay. But for the extreme rides, I usually keep my eyes closed, and I just enjoy how the inner circle, the inner center is moving, because keeping my eyes open, God, no.
Okay, thank you. Somebody else? Questions?
How did you decide to give this talk? Because this was a pretty brave thing to do.
With the giving the talks, the thing is, when you go to the conferences, you're in the uplift, and then you're quite easily influenceable by the cool people. I do know that it took me a while from when you and Marit told me to do the talk, but it was in the spur of the moment when I was in a good mood, an uplifted spirit, like, why not to submit to a conference? And of course, once you press submit, it's like, what the hell did I just do? So it's like, sometimes you should let yourself do the scary, crazy thing and then let the reality check in. Or better not, don't, because then you can prepare properly.
Okay, thank you.
Marit had one.
You've done very brave things. Wow. Do you have advice that you would give to your team members or people you work with that how they could be brave in their own scale?
Well, the main thing that I would definitely want to suggest is observe your team members. Because if you just go with the loud personality and talk straight to the face, you will make it worse, especially for the timid ones who are even with the ones who look loud and social and active. The thing is, so another confession I have to, I don't have to make, but I will, is that I'm not as secure as I might visually seem. I have heard people saying, oh, she likes to talk a lot and she probably likes how her voice sounds, but my bunch of words come out whenever I'm stressed and I don't really know the answer, so the problem is I don't stop to think, write down, evolve the answer that I would be giving. So I try to answer and then I even forget how I started. So returning back to the question is try to observe, see how when the person opens up to what the person reacts and then tailor the behavior and like model how you would approach it, because there isn't one unified way how to talk to the people. Everyone is different. Everyone have their own triggers. Even habits, not everyone has the same habits. We might have some general things, which is it's easier to do the short-term goals and short-term gains rather than long-term. But just try to observe and see whether there is something that you can help, because we do need help.